हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम इन आवर इंग्लिश लेक्चर। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू लर्न फ्रॉम यूनिट नंबर 6.1 दैट नेम इज दिस इज जॉडीज फोन। सो स्टूडेंट्स, ऑफन इंस्टेड ऑफ रशिंग टू द डॉक्टर टू ट्रीट अ स्मॉल कट और बर्न, वी फाइंड क्विक एंड इफेक्टिव क्योर्स using these things available at home. Can you think of some such a home remedies for a cut on your knees? So what we are using? We are using the turmeric. Then burn on your arms. So for that also we are using the ink. Sometime we are using the Colgate. And or a bee sting. So for that we are using the oil. So students, in this story, Jody's father has been bitten by a rattlesnake and he quickly kills a doe, means a mother deer, and he uses its heart and liver to draw out the poison of that snake. So Jody wonders what will happen to the little fawn left without a mother. So he was thinking all over about this. So what happened that we will see in this story. But before that, this story is written by with that author, that Major Canon Rawlings. So first of all, we will take the information about that writer and then we will see the remaining things. So Major Canon Rawlings was an American author who is born on 8 August 1896 and he died on December 14, 1953. She lived in a rural Florida and wrote novels with rural themes and settings. Her best known work, The Yearling About a Boy Who Adopts an Orphaned Fawn, won a Pulitzer Prize for Fiction in the 1939 and was later made into the movie of the same name. The book was written long before the concept of young adult fiction. So this is encouraged by her editors, Scribner's Maxwell Perkins, who was impressed by the letter. She wrote him about her life in the Cross Creek. Rawlings began writing stories set in the Florida scrub country. Then, and Jacob Ladder, both about the poor backcountry Florida resident who were quite similar to her neighbors at the Cross Creek. In local reception to her, the stories was mixed between the puzzlement concern whom she was writing about the rich, since mother apparently recognized her son as subject a story. Her first novel, South Moon Under, was published in the 1933. The book captured the richness of Cross Creek and is humorous in the telling the story of young man Land, who his first novel South Moon Under was published in the 1933. The book captured the richness of Cross Creek and its environs in the telling the story of young man Land, who must support himself and his mother by making and selling moonshine, and what he must do when the treacherous cousins threatens to turn him in. Moonshiners were the subject of the several of her stories, and Rawlings lived with a moonshiner for several weeks near the Ocala to prepare for writing the book. South Moon Under was included in the Book of the Month Club and was the finalist for the Pulitzer Prize. So students, here we saw more things about the author. Now what really happened in this story? that we are going to see with the animated stories. Now we will take the reading and explanation about this lesson. So I hope students you understood the introduction of this lesson as well as the author's introduction. So let's start our lesson now. Jody allowed his thoughts to drift back to the farm, could not keep out him. His mind he had made held in his dreams in his arms. He slipped from the table and went to his father's beside. Penny lay at rest. His eyes were open and clear, but pupils were still dark and delighted. Jody said, "How are you feeling, Pa?" "Just fine, son. Old Death has gone thieving elsewhere, but wasn't it a close shave?" "I agree," Penny said. "I am proud of you, boy. The way you kept your head and did what was needed." "Ba, yes, son." "Pa, do you recollect the door and the fawn? I can never leave them. The poor dog saved me that certain bar. Might be hungry and very scared." "I suppose so, far. I am big boy now and don't need to drink milk. Why I go and see if I can find the fawn and bring it to here and raise it?" Penny lay quietly and staring at the ceiling. "Boy, you have got me emptying it. It won't take much to raise it, bar and stool start eating leaves and acorns. You were smarter than boys of your age. We took its mother, and it wasn't to be blamed, surely. It seems ungrateful to leave it to starve. I, son, I can't say you know. You never thought I would live see another day with meal will. And see if I can find, I tell you, Ma said. Back to the table and sat down. His mother was pouring coffee for everyone. He said, "Ma, Pa says that I can go bring back the fawn." He held at the coffee pot in the middle. "And what for the fawn belonging to the door? Can we use the door silver to draw out the poison and save Pa?" She gasped, "Wow, for pity's sake, Pa. Says it would be ungrateful to leave the staff." Doc Wilson said, "Nothing in the world comes quite free." "The boy's right, and his daddy's right," Millville said. "He can ride back with me. I will help him to find it." She set down the pot helplessly. "Will, if you give it milk, we have got nothing else, feed it," Millville said. "Come on, boy, we have got get riding on, Ma Boxer asked anxiously. "You will not be gone long," Jody said. "I will be back before dinner." Millville mounted his horse and Jody up behind him. अब ये दोनों जंगल में चले गए. He said to Millville, "Do you think the fawn's still there? Will you help me find?" "He will find. He is alive, too. Do you know he is the spots where all in line and doe fawn says the spots are very in way." Jody gave himself over the thoughts of the fawn. They passed the downward clearing. He said, "Cut to the warm." "Millville, it was up there that got bitten by the snake and killed the doe, and I saw the fawn." Suddenly Jody was unwilling to have Millville with him. "If the fawn was dead or could not be found, I could not have his disappointment seen. And if the fawn was there in the meeting, would so lovely and so secret that he could not endure to share it," said. "It's not for fawn now, but scrub is very thick for the horse. I can make it to foot on the butt. I'm afraid to leave, boy," Suppose you got lost, forgot, bitten by the snake. I will take care it. Might take care long time. I find the phone. If you wanted, give me off. Right, they're all right. But you take easy. Now you know there is a east there and there. That tall pine makes a bearing so long. So long meal will I am obliged. So now that he waited for the saw hose to the end, then cut the right, the scrub was still only his own crackling of twigs sounded across the silence. Wondered for instant if he had mistake in the direction, then a buzzard rose in front of him and flapped into the air. He came into the clearing under the oaks. Buzzards sat in a circle around the carcass of the doe. They turned their heads on their dog's scrawny neck and hissed at him. He threw his bow at them and then he flew into an adjacent tree. The sand showed large cat prints and big cats killed fresh, and the lift the doe, the carrion birds. He parted the grass at the place where he had seen the fawn. He did not seem possible that it was only yesterday the fawn was not there in a circle clearing. There was no sound, so sign. Bizarre clapped their wings impatient to return their business. He returned to spot where the fawn had emerged and dropped on all fours studying the sand for the small hoofs prints. The rides rain had washed away all the tracks except those of the cat and buzzard's movement directly in front of him started him that he crumbled backwards. The fawn lifted its face. It turned his head with wide wondering motion and shook him with the scales of its liquid eyes. It was cawing. It made no effort to rise or run. Jody could not thrust himself to move. His whispered its mean from the lifted his nose sending him. He reached out one hand and did it on the soft neck, the touch of him delirious. He moved forward on all fours until he was close. Body of light convulsion passed over, but it did not stir. He stroked its sides as gently as through the break. All its skin was very soft. It was sleek and clean and had a sweet scent of grass. He rose slowly and lifted the fawn from the ground. Its legs hung limply. They were surmising long and had as possible under his arm. He was afraid that might kick the bleed the sight of smell of his mother's and strike the clearing and pushed it away into the thick was difficult to fight through with the burden. He could not lift his son with freedom, afraid, shield his face from the prickling vines. Its head bobbed with his sides, its heart thumped with the marvels of this acceptance of he reached the tail. So home stopped to rest and set the fawn down. Its dull dangling waved on them, looked at him and bleated. He some chanted, I will carry you after I get my breath. Remembered, I follow it first has been carried. Started away slowly, fawn started after him. Come back into the stroke, it and walked away again it took. अब जॉडी क्या किया हुआ था? जॉडी ने उसे उठाकर लाया हुआ था. अब थोड़ी देर चलने के बाद जॉडी फिर से उसे उठा रहा था, लेकिन फोन छोटा था इसलिए ज़्यादा देर तक नहीं चल पा रहा था. तो थोड़ी देर के लिए जॉडी उसे नीचे छोड़ता था और बाद में फिर से अपने हाथों में उठाकर वो उसे चल रहा था. मतलब जॉडी उसे पकड़ने में अभी क्या हो चुका था? सक्सेसफुल हो चुका था. So his arms began to eat and was forced to stop again when he walked on the fawn, followed him, and once he allowed to walk a little distance, then he picked up again the distance. Home was nothing. He could have walked into day into night carrying it and watching it follow the was wet with sweat, but a light breeze blew through the June morning, cooling him. The sky was clear as spring. In a blue china cup, he came to the clearing. It was fresh and green after the night's rain. He fined with the latch and watch finally oblique to set down to the phone, managed to hear them. He had no idea he would walk into the house, into the Penny's bedroom, with the phone walking behind him at the steps. The phone bought and refused to climb, this picked up and went to his father's. Penny lay with closed eyes. Jody called, "Pa, look." Penny turned his head. Jody stood beside him, the phone clutched hard against him. It seemed Penny that boy's eyes were as bright as the phone. He said, "I'm glad you to found him, Jody." Then went back the kitchen. The phone wobbled after him. Pan of morning milk stood in the kitchen state. The cream had risen on it, skimmed cream into the jug. He poured me into a small gourd. He held out to the form the buttered. It suddenly smelling the milk he saved and preciously from spilling over the floor. It could make nothing of the milk. In the good God dipped fingers in the milk and thrust them into the fawn's soft wet mouth, sucked greedily. When he withdrew them, belated frankly and bitten him, the dipped his fingers again. And as the fawn sucked the lard, them slowly into the milk, and then fawn blew, sucked and snored. It stamped its small hose impatiently as long as below the level of milk fawn was contained the closed. Means now that Jody bring that fawn at home. उसे घर पर लाने के बाद पापा बहुत खुश हो चुके थे. उनकी आँखों में एक चमक ही दिख रही थी. तो जॉडी ने जो सुबह का मिल्क था वो उसे पिलाया था. उसे एक उंगली चाटने के बाद वो खुद से वो दूध पीने लगा था. मीन्स नाउ जॉडी वॉज सक्सेसफुल टू ब्रिंग द फोन एट होम. सो आई होप स्टूडेंट्स यू अंडरस्टूड दैट स्टोरी, हाउ द फोन केम ऑन द जॉडीज होम, वॉट हैपन रियल थिंग, दैट ऑल द थिंग्स यू लर्न अबाउट इट. सो थैंक यू स्टूडेंट्स, हैप्पी लर्निंग.